A few weeks ago, I was walking downtown when I noticed that art gallery that's right next to the Starbucks. Do you know the one I'm talking about? Some of you do, yes. I had never been inside of it, so on a whim, I went in and checked it out. And in the gallery, I met the artist, who was kind but didn't speak very much. And I walked through the gallery, I admired his art, which included a painting by his five-year-old son. It was this picture of a man who had half of a curly mustache on one side of his face. And as I was buying a few postcards, the artist thanked me. And based on his accent, I thought that he might speak Spanish. So I said, as I was preparing to leave, ¿hablas español? And with that question, the artist turned into a completely different person. I learned that his name is Coque, which comes from a childhood mispronunciation of his real name, Jorge. And since I can understand a lot more Spanish than I can speak, it was my turn to be kind and quiet. Coque told me that he has lived and worked all over Europe, including in Paris, and he moved to Andover area just a few years ago. He opened this gallery, and he wanted to create a space where locals could come and just enjoy art. He hopes that folks will stop by after they get their Starbucks latte, but says that they rarely do. He also told me that what I thought was a mustache on the side of that man that his son painted was actually a booger. Coque walked me around his gallery, telling me about some of his work. He pointed at a large painting of a horse and asked me what I saw. And I said, "A horse." "Look closer," he said. Suddenly, it wasn't just a horse. In the mane, I could see just the outline of a spine. In the top corner was the face of an old man. Trailing off of the horse were wings. In another painting, I saw Christ on a cross, but looked closer, and he was covered in roses. Painting after painting, Coque showed me the layers of worlds he has created, and I noticed things that I hadn't noticed before. The whole interaction felt like a lesson in uncovering, a reminder of all of the depths that go unnoticed. Part of why I love preaching Palm Sunday is because this is a story with depth. It is a passage that is worthy of a second look, a moment rife with layers and tension and wonder, a picture that reveals itself slowly over time. On the surface, it is a joyful procession. The crowd recognizes Jesus as he rides into town and welcomes him as their Messiah. Looking closer, you may notice the irony that this crowd that hails Jesus as king today will shout for his execution on Friday. And if you look at the story even closer, off in the distance of the picture, there's another procession happening on the other side of town. And before we visit that other procession, let's set the scene. The occasion is Passover, a feast that would bring Jewish pilgrims from all over Judea to the capital city of Jerusalem for the week. Jewish pilgrims, including Jesus and his disciples, in fact. The bread and the cup that Jesus will lift up in the first story of communion on Thursday comes directly off of the Passover table. In Passover, the Jewish people remember the story of the Exodus, when God led them out of slavery in Egypt and into the promised land. By Jesus' day, Israel had been captured and conquered a few more times since Egypt, most recently by Rome. And under the watchful eye of the Roman military, the people gathered once again to celebrate resistance and liberation. Needless to say, Passover was a tense time in Jerusalem. The Roman authorities were on edge. Those in power often fear collective action, and they should. In order to keep control over the city, in order to keep the peace, every year Rome would make a huge display of its military power, starting with a huge military procession at the main gate to the city. In this procession, the one we see off in the distance of the Palm Sunday scene, the Roman governor Pontius Pilate will ride into Jerusalem on a war horse, flanked by the full strength of the Roman army. The message is clear. We're here for Passover, too. Roman military control was known to be crushing. Sympathizers would call it the peace of Rome, but lack of conflict, as we know, is not the same thing as peace. A generation after Jesus, a Roman historian and politician named Tacitus said, "The Romans rob, they slaughter, they plunder, and they call it empire. Where they make a wasteland, they call it peace." By the way, from our position as citizens of a global military superpower, we do well to remember that we may be disciples, but we are also Romans. So the question is this: which procession do we attend? Which peace do we believe in? The peace of Rome or the peace of Christ? The presence of Jesus and the building tension between the processions has the Pharisees a little bit nervous. Pharisees often get a bad rep in churches, which I think says more about us than them. In reality, the Pharisees were local Jewish leaders working to preserve the safety and customs of their people in difficult times. There had already been bloody rebellions in the history of Judaism, so you can't blame them for wanting to keep the peace. They tried to warn Jesus earlier in Luke that King Herod was trying to kill him, but Jesus refuses to be silent. In today's passage, he quotes the Hebrew Bible prophet Habakkuk, saying that if the people were silent, the stones would cry out. So deep and long is their suffering, the foundations of the walls groan with their pain. It's hard to ignore the feeling that in our own time and place, the foundations once again cry out. We have cities and houses and churches built by enslaved and oppressed people of color. Our earth bears the scars of exploitation. Our nation groans with a mental health epidemic and a looming election. There is no shortage of things to be anxious about. If these stones were silent, if we were silent, the stones would cry out. The size of the problems that we face can be paralyzing. They are complex and hard to fully understand or access. Meaningful change is slow. It's hard to see. It's overwhelming. And beloveds, I think that's by design. If we are too intimidated to act, if we are forever waiting for that one big thing that will save us, we are no threat to those who benefit from the status quo. Like Rome before them, the oppressors of our time and place want us to believe that they are inevitable, eternal. But here's the secret. The kingdom is at hand. Meaningful change is closer than we think. Every week we pray together, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done." This is not a request we are making of God. This is a promise. Thy kingdom come, Lord God, thy will be done. It is our commitment to live differently. It is a mission statement for disciples. See, changing the world for the better does not require us to commit one large act of heroism. It requires lots of people to commit to the immediate good around them. The world doesn't need heroes nearly as much as it needs communities. People gather together to do their small good, to lay down their coat or their palm, and to sing together, "Hosanna." The Reverend Dr. Mary Luty, maybe you've heard of her, the Reverend Dr. Mary Luty says that the church is here to start a revolution of love. If love is the revolution we are here to start, then the picture of what we're supposed to be doing looks a little bit different, doesn't it? Maybe it includes the usual suspects, protests and donations and signs, but it also includes celebrating the people you love, being patient and kind to strangers, having hard conversations with family and friends, practicing gratitude and care for our earth. See, it involves small habits that draw us closer to one another. As I was leaving Koke's art gallery, what struck me most is that I would have never been able to meet him and have this wonderful experience if I hadn't decided, kind of on a whim, 7 years ago, to start learning Spanish for 5 minutes a day. I didn't really have a reason to do it, except that I knew that eventually it would help me connect with people. So the point of my sermon is not go learn Spanish, although it's not a bad idea. The point of my sermon is do whatever small good you can and trust that the Spirit will lead people to your efforts. I wonder what gifts and interests you hold that might help you connect more deeply with the world around you. Today marks the end of our sermon series on prayer, and I think it's important that we end here with the recognition that prayer is embodied. It is not simply wishing that God's kingdom would come and God's will would be done. It is acting to make it so. To embody prayer is to decide that God's revolution of love will start right where we are standing. To embody prayer is to live deeply in your own context, to commit to building relationships with the human and non-human beings who live beside you. It is to build small habits of attention and care, as trusting as the owners of that cult, as spontaneous as the crowd, as committed as Jesus. We are called not to do this work alone, but in radical community. In church, we gather our small goods together for the life of the world. This is what an offering truly is, an offering of all kinds, love, time, prayer, talent. Today, one of the small goods that we are offering is this. After worship, we will go downstairs and we will share a meal together. We will celebrate our gathered gifts, and there will be enough for everyone. Whether or not you have cooked, you will be fed. Whether or not you are a member of this church, you will be fed. Without charge, you will be fed, because the kingdom of God is a table big enough for the whole world. Won't the people of God say amen?